Okay, this would be the second video in a long series. I actually made a second video, and it was about ChatGPT and generating AI images, harkening back to my past in Second Life and the transhumanist there, and the idea of creating virtual spaces or virtual environments. Or creating whatever visual or stimulating, whatever. It was a long video, and I made a stupid mistake of putting a link in the video to some semi-erotic pictures of Second Life play. And YouTube banned the video, deleted the video, and threw me off for a week. That's a strike. Yeah, this is a problem. And I don't know how to resolve it because I will always instinctively say or link things that are that trigger the algorithms or across the boundaries of YouTube. And I self-censorship for me is tricky, as a lot of people may have noticed. Today I will. Today is basically like an impromptu reaction, plus a whole bunch of stuff that ties into that. To the video yesterday was launched by Natalie Wynne, also known as ContraPoints. She blew me away, like she is a habit of doing. I am extremely sad that Natalie doesn't do more videos on a more regular basis. The last one was 11 months ago, I believe, which is just not enough. Yeah, she should maybe get people around her that help her, or maybe choose a lifestyle, or maybe make alterations in her process, get staff. Probably she already has lots of people, editors, and this and that. But the production value of this video was a very straight video, very straight. Conversation, background, there was even daylight coming through, like here. And she was clearly recording day and night, editing it with a bunch of people. But she is a original, very original thinker, and a very charismatic thinker, and she clearly has a very strong ego, which is like the 90% of, like 75% of her charm. But she is also super nuanced. This was like an exercise in great nuance about the trans debate. I will link the video in the description, and I will definitely urge anyone to watch the 1 hour and 55 minutes of this video. For me, the maximum amount of time for a video is 1 hour, which is already ridiculously long. Naturally, people will completely watch a video because she has a rabid fan base that will share this video everywhere. It is frustrating. She's really good. I wish I had anywhere near the motivation and the vision and the general I give a damn about these topics to actually get involved. I'm not hungry enough, as Schwarzenegger would say. Most of the days I don't care, and I'm in a sort of blessed position that I don't need to care, living as I do right now in Amsterdam. One minor thing which irritates me enormously, as you may know, I had facial feminization surgery, and the facial feminization surgery was in 2018, like three surgical treatments, and they overlap with a facial paralysis. So I have a facial paralysis because of misadventure in my very earliest years. This works, and this side doesn't. It is like a nerve damage. The doctor, my plastic surgeon, tried doing something about it by making like a sort of like a little support, and then they tried to make the support a little stronger, and it broke. Literally, that thread or wire in my face broke, and I felt it snap. Actually, it hurt like hell. And then she put in something that would lift this, and again something that would lift this to the nose, I think. And it was all very contrived. And as you see, it is not working. If I compare to a bunch of years ago, there's some advantages, but there's also some drawbacks. The sensation, especially after the reduction of my chin, the sensation in my chin is gone. I have like a tingling feeling here, and this lip does nothing anymore. That basically means I very consistently make this kind of sound, and it irritates the hell out of me, but it's very difficult to do anything about it. When I'm eating or drinking in a restaurant or somewhere, I'm constantly wiping my face. I tried to impress this on my plastic surgeon, and she was dismissive about it. She said, like, "Oh yeah, you're getting older, huh?" Which was about as frustrating as it could get in life. So tomorrow I have a follow-up treatment for that. That basically means that of 19 April, I will be several weeks, most likely scarred or getting used to this new situation. It is going to be scar management here, and it's going to be scar management here. I hope this tightens up like this. And I hope this will give some definition back, but I'm extremely pessimistic about it. You see, I this is literally like an immobile mask. It's become an immobile mask, and I overcompensate by doing this with my lips, and I really hate this. But yeah, I can't do anything about that. I'm quite sorry. Today, my vidcast, as I said, it will tie in with ContraPoints. And a favorite topic of mine, which is like harkens back to a publication of Jeremiah Caskio around 2001, 2002, I believe. You can look it up, toxic memes. I mentioned it before. The idea is that memetics could be at some point a science. And there comes a very scary prediction. I believe that it's already becoming, well, not a science, but more like an art with predictable precursor actions leading towards sort of catalyzed changes in public opinion, manipulation of the Overton windows, and other mischief. I think it's intentional. I don't think, well, I will touch upon it step by step. So it's about memetics. What a ContraPoint touch upon is the current hysteria on the trans groomer debate. What she says is just perfect. It's complete. I can't add anything to that. I wouldn't even dare to summarize what she says, or to translate it, or to interpret it, because it's too good. She goes back and forth on both sides so exhaustively and so responsively, even like having like highlighting incidents that happened to her in her adventures across the blogosphere with other leftists like Vaush. And it is it's just I won't touch it. It's too good. But I mention what it's about, and then you can check for yourself. So J.K. Rowling's persists in her how do I say this most politely? A pervasive paranoia and fear of males invading female spaces in a broader sense, to the point of supporting fellow red femmes, TERFs, lesbians, I don't know, and quoting a bunch of philosophers in that field, that basically go a little further and says we have to completely expunge the idea of medical transition. We cannot have that. There are icy-eyed, angry-stared red femmes, how do I call them, out there that literally say things that are completely dismissing the idea of transition and surgery, and they consider it a like there's other issues, which is a shorthand for people who have trans issues are suffering from psychiatric delusions or derangements or trauma or whatever. Even my best friend Amanda occasionally hinted at this, You can't do that anymore these days, I think. But it touches upon the emancipation of any minority, be it people with like obesitas or people who have chronic diseases that are not recognized by science, or more recently, people who have long COVID, which is like a considerable amount of people in all countries, even in the Netherlands. There's now an enormous amount of people with long COVID where the government says, yeah, well, it's not our problem. And they basically let people figure it out, and people lose their houses and end up in welfare or worse. There are people that are literally not unable to walk for long distances. So work is not an option, and any solution is immediately, there's no collective infrastructure of dealing with this problem right now. So that brings us to an interesting conclusion. There was a lot of COVID denial, understatement of the century. There was a lot of COVID denial in the last years. Before that, there was already a lot of vaccine denial, and it bears mentioning what that is. I would summarize it in this context of this discourse as a pervasive hostility of a wide range of people. Let me say something about that. A wide range of demographics who are completely losing their nerve and becoming militantly hostile towards intellectualism, the political system, democracy, dialogue, peaceful society, the left-right divide. There is an infrastructure, sort of like a societal, mimetic, collective neurological infrastructure in people that is gestating, I would call it festering, that is mobilizing these mechanisms. Like, why would people with children don't want to vaccinate their kids? Well, there is in their mind sort of like a burgeoning conviction that vaccination is bad for their kids and the benefits don't outweigh the risks. So vaccinating is bad. Your kid might get autism or sneeze a lot or whatever, asthma. Yeah, it's then better not to vaccinate because nature will take care of itself. I'm going to say something really harsh. That these are people that are either like caught in sort of like a sort of destructive, toxic subcultures. I'm not immediately going full Scientology in this matter, but like say the sort of spiritual people with sort of holistic views about reality, spiritual people with a spiritual take on life, homeopathy, whatever. I wouldn't say hippies, but like people who are on the sort of left spectrum and who are pervasively hostile of science, medical technology, corporate medical infrastructures, etc. Another demographic is basically people that are shitty, that have shitty education. If you go to a protest of COVID protest, a vaccination protest in the last few years, you would have a, like discussed things with people, and I would end up with a persistent impression that these people have no clue what the fuck they're talking about. They are literally clueless. They are so horribly educated and quite often so stupid that they just like this is just one cement mixer in their head of complete and utter garbage and nonsense. That is shocking. But yeah, who am I to say to those people, hey, you're a dumbass and you didn't pay attention at school. Who am I? I didn't finish anything. But yeah, the second demographic is this the people who are like suffering, they have holes in their education and understanding of the world. Another demographic, to be really bluntly about it, are people with like clear psychiatric disorders. Again, if you go to a COVID meeting, you will meet those people. Without any doubt, you will look at those people and says, that one, autism spectrum, that one is like traumatized. That one has serious problems with authority for like some childhood reason. Schizophrenia. There is a firing up element in the conspiracy crowd in the conspiracy industrial complex, where people are susceptible. That brings me to the next step. I've discussed this with my friend Amanda quite a bit. I mention her quite a bit because she's one of the great inspirations in my life, and it is about the idea that the government doesn't take enough measures. She is very insistent about it. And of course, there's very good evidence for what she says, or arguments that what she says is completely correct. Right now, Netherlands is one of the most liberal countries with regards to how to deal with COVID. We decide that COVID doesn't exist, which is not true. We're not testing. There is no way to get vaccinations. There is nothing. There's nothing. There's no infrastructure. COVID is gone. COVID is gone. COVID is gone. You see here and there a smattering of people that still wear a mask, mostly Asians. There's a chance that if you wear a mask that you will get some abuse or insults. So people are hostile to the idea of wearing a mask even. So if you wear a mask to protect them from COVID, they will say, don't wear a mask, it's rude. And what can you do with that? Amanda persistently states that COVID still exists. There are still major mutations going around, and she's super well informed. Then we end up in a discussion that skirts around the edges of conspiracy theory. Why would the Dutch government, and also probably every other government, just have a very strong incentive to deny the existence of COVID? You see that in China. There was like, at one time, the Chinese model was, we are going to fight COVID no matter what, even if they'll kill people to fight COVID, we all will. People were committing suicide left and right in China, actually quite badly. And the system was close to collapse after 3 years, so two, yeah, 20, 21, 22, yeah, 3 years or so of major COVID measures in China. And then the Chinese government says, okay, we're basically destroying the country, we're losing the people. Let's stop with all the measures. I don't know what the current status quo in China is, but I think they kind of gave up on COVID measures. And they says, okay, if we have to take like several million deaths and several 10 millions of people with long-term disability as a result of COVID infection. And in China, this is a lot more acute because they don't have really good vaccination programs there. China does statistically nothing. They gave up. And the same happens in a sort of more vanilla, folderish kind of way here in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands here right now, the government's saying, well, COVID doesn't exist. It's a flu. Well, everyone's vaccinated who could have been vaccinated. It's not our responsibility. If you have COVID symptoms, you should stay at home and don't infect people, which nobody does. And the government says, well, let's try to minimize costs, which they have kind of, Rutte, our current prime minister, kind of has like a pathological habit of minimizing costs, like pushing people in the ravine, so to speak. There is a whole bunch of grotesque scandals going around here in the Netherlands with like the winning of gas and the effects of earthquakes. People being charged with fraud in terms of child support or other subsidies and losing all access to the subsidy system, having to pay back, basically losing their kids taken away from them, people again committing suicide, people like completely ruined. And it was all literally to blame with the government. The government took policies in the last 10 years which destroyed the livelihoods and well-being of people to a degree where they were wrecked as human beings. If that would happen to me, anything close to that, I would have been long dead, literally, because I need medication. I need like quite a few infrastructures to keep me alive. I empathize with the sort of perceived ruthlessness of what our government and governments all over the world are doing. So they literally say, and again, I'm saying this skirts conspiracy theories, I'm literally saying the government's making a calculation where they say, let's keep the economy going and we'll take the deaths and we'll deal with the deaths, or we'll try to denounce the long COVID cases. If you say you have long COVID, you should prove it. It's not our responsibility. You have a vaccination. Did you take your vaccination? We don't know what's up. It's all a surprise for us as well. And that's the typical Rutte strategy, is pretend to be a little stupid, or I don't know. So that is like a choice, and that is memetics. That is it's no longer about managing systems. It's literally denying systems. It's literally abandoning infrastructures or welfare or medical care, and it's managing the effects of this on society, on people, on their behavior. I think it was quite fortunate for the government that you had such sometimes irrational COVID deniers. And then I'm veering definitely conspiracy theories. Why was there so much media attention to the nutcases? We call them in the Netherlands wappies. It's like a sort of reference to being cuckoo. A wappie was used in circles of like being heavily on drugs, you were wappie. Or if you were in a sort of emotional state, like a hyper agitated state, you were wappie. COVID denial. It was sort of practical to have a bunch of nutcases, so you could say, oh, look at those nutcases, we discredit them. And then we just can be basically, we can salvage our policies and saying and showcasing, demonstrating that the opposition in the dialogue was basically completely nuts. So we take a step beyond that, which is clearly not longer conspiracy theory, and that is Russian propaganda. Russia, for its own reasons, has been persistently propagandizing the West, particular America. Definitely there is a link with the Trump nightmare 4 year clusterfuck. What happened here in Europe? Europe, Brexit, COVID, left-wing politics, right-wing politics. What Russian does is all about division, and it literally, I'm certain. I say certain, it is about division. I think there are direct links from Russia and emphasizing the conservative qualities of Russia, the church, the family values, procreation, racism. Russia is at the core of a country, like a significantly more racist society than any country, with the possible exceptions of Poland or something. In Europe, Russia is an extremely hostile nation to minorities. It's an ethno state, but you don't notice because a lot of other problems in Russia are a lot more pressing. But Russia is feeling threatened, has been feeling threatened for quite a while. And so what they do is they funnel considerable amount of their societal resources, their state resources, to engineered propaganda, memetics, societal disruption, and it touches closely on a whole bunch of right-wing billionaires in the West, funneling money at, say, climate change denial, smoking isn't bad, liberals, progressives, trans, etc. And that is extremely important for people to realize. I have no way to impress this on people. This video won't convince many people. Not many people will watch this, most likely. But the essence of it, it's become so easy to just grab from, like, as a hostile enemy, as a hostile entity, grab an issue, sprinkle some propaganda money or Hasvara is the word, I think. Some highly structured media, social media activity, little videos, little posts, and constantly crowbar into every crevice you can get. So the trans debate is, I think, a very clear example of that. And that is why it's so frustrating, because I am actually trans, for those who didn't know this. I started this process quite a bit before this was an issue, on the cusp of like, oh, this is becoming acceptable. Oh, you're so courageous. On the cusp of that, I started 2010-ish, with the help of what the fuck is that? With the help of a very good friend in America, very good friends in America. I came back transition early transition from when I stayed in America, and I was extremely happy about that. It worked so well for me, the process and the effects of the process, which is saying something about the male state, which is not super uplifting these days. It's very easy to take the trans topic because, as I see it, we are experiencing an enormous backlog of people that are very unsatisfied the way society works and way their position in society works. And for an increasing number of people, like it's a flood. It's like that the dams are breaking. An increasing number of people fully well and rationally realize, all by themselves, and they don't need any state propaganda or whatever, or brainwashing. A whole bunch of young kids realize, if I transition, this is the benefit. I mentioned that in the video that was deleted by YouTube. The concept is called transmaxing, which is basically saying boys that are nominally bisexual or not even bisexual, they just transition, then the whole world, oh, you're so courageous, and they get all these little sort of societal benefits. And you will find that even if you're not, like, if you're a guy that is not super high in the sexual marketplace, and then you become a chick or trans chick that is not super high in the sexual marketplace, overwhelmingly, your quality of life will increase. Even if you're like balding and not, you're just so courageous, and it is a wonderful experience on my end, of course. I love it, but I think a whole bunch of kids are realizing how this works, and their parents are nonplussed, confused. So, some external actor, conspiracy theory, I suppose, either Russian or a vehemently right-wing billionaire, or I don't know, some radical elements in the Vatican, or Muslims, or whatever, or corporations that have a certain business model based on conservatism. They just funnel money at it, and they use transgenders as some sort of bugbear, I think is the word in English. You can blame a whole bunch of society ills on that issue, and then nobody looks at climate change. Nobody looks at disparity. Nobody looks at gun violence. If you play it right, you can even blame a whole bunch of problems we have on this. There's problems with people not procreating. It's the trans. There's racial violence and sexual violence. It's the trans and the woke. People demand too much rights. Oh, fuck the woke. Oh my God. Social justice warriors. And it becomes sort of like a go-to motif. And I think that a whole bunch of people in these circles completely understand what's happening. Talking to, I would say, right winger, but like, say, I wouldn't say conspiracy artist, I wouldn't say flat earther, I wouldn't say hyper conservative, something in between. Those people, that cluster of people, a whole bunch of people realize, just fine, just okay, I'm racist. I am like a fascist. I don't like democracy. I hate gays. I can't get a girlfriend or whatever. Those circles of people, and I'm lumping a whole bunch of crap together, they know what they're doing. And actually, Natalie Wynne ContraPoints discussed this at length in her older work when she was calling herself the right-wing whisperer, I think fascist whisperer. Basically, she was having dialogues with ultra-right-wingers and trying to get them to re-radicalize, which she actually was extremely successful at, according to the statistics. A whole bunch of people realized being like faced rationally and level-headedly with arguments that they, oh fuck, I'm turning into an asshole. Oh my God, I have to really change my ways. Otherwise, I'll be horribly unhappy 10, 20 years from now. A whole bunch of these people realize full well what's happening and what they're doing and how they are leveling the system. And I think already also in the right-wing circles, hyper-conservative circles, racist circles, fascist circles, whatever. There is probably a direct support network or linkage to, well, Moscow. Yeah, literally, Moscow. I think they are getting notes and they're comparing notes and making policy choices, and the subsidies are being spread to certain actors, and people on TikTok get money, and people on Facebook get money, and maybe some agency here in Amsterdam gets money. And people don't talk about it too loudly, but I think there isn't like there is a sort of like an industry in there in that area. Shall I say this? Yeah, I'm going to say this. I think that in 2016, 17-ish, I received an offer because I can be misconstrued as fairly anti-establishmentarian. I think I received an offer. It was like a sort of like a casual conversation, like online. And I emailed back after a year or two when I was decidedly more suspicious, and the email was already gone. It was already canceled, deleted. So yeah, it was very ephemeral, but I think I got an offer. Do you want to use your skills and be paid for that? I could say something about infiltration in certain political. There was like a lot of talk in the Pirate Party. Yeah, we suspect that one is CIA, and we suspect that one is probably Russian. Yeah, that was around 2013, when I was in my early stage of transition. Yeah, there was already talk, a lot of talk back then. Like there was infiltration. Yeah, mostly. Corporate, Russian, American, European intelligence agencies, and I don't know. So this was a thing, and I think from that angle, I made a few speech, I made a few presentations in Croatia and in Serbia. You can look them up online. I was on the stage with Bruce Sterling and Aubrey de Grey. Yeah, and I think I was noticed, and they were definitely cautiously recruiting me. Someone was starting to recruit me, and if I look at the tenor of that particular dialogue, which I can barely remember, it's like 10 years ago, it was probably Russia. It was probably Russia. They were offering money at the time, but not saying that out loud. There's no clear evidence or paper trail. The moment I would have compromised myself up to the neck, I would have probably be oh yeah, okay, this is apparently Russia. Okay, I'm talking to someone from the FSB right now, probably. But then we would be several years later, and I would have been completely compromised up the wazoo. Yeah, that brings us to the following. A major part of all this, I think all of it, or 99% of it, like let's say like the big problem here is disparity. We call it these days, we call it precariousness, precarity, the precariat. A whole segment of society is so fucking overworked. There we go again, YouTube is going to. They're so catastrophically overworked right now. Is that people are in emergency states, especially after Corona. This was already like topic, a major topic in 2008 for me. I posted about it, I blogged about it, I was talking about it in my extremely chaotic blog posts and statements. This has always been a thing, but it's become so abundantly clear that history in the 1970s zagged when it should have zigged. It went in the wrong direction, probably as a result of the Nixon oil shock and gold and fiat currency and banking and a whole bunch of things and oil and whatever. A whole bunch of things happened. And then in the 1970s, the rich got richer, the incomes of the rich got richer, and the poor stayed exactly at a horizontal level, as almost if it was like surgically engineered. If you're rich, you get more. And if you're not rich, you don't have any say in the system. Look at the sketches of Carlin, the comedy, stand-up comedy, and Carlin and Bill Hicks. They got it, and they both mysteriously died. Conspiracy theory. Yeah, these are things that are already abundantly discussed. A good friend of mine, Arjen Kamphuis, who mysteriously died a few years ago while canoeing off the coast in Norway. I consider myself a complete another friend of him. I don't know if he would do the same, but we were definitely all spokesperson. He was like a fellow transhumanist. He was one of the first that started Transvision Conference here in 1998 in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam, like all places. Jesus, if I'd known, I would have been there. We were meshing 100%, and he was super cognizant, rational, highly educated, well-voiced, eloquent, stable, mentally stable, sharp-eyed security specialist who worked with security firms. He worked, I think, with WikiLeaks and with Snowden and all that, like a direct line to them. And like as I said, mysteriously, he drowned. His canoe tipped or something like that off the coast of Norway, and his corpse was never found. And there were some irregularities because his phone flipped on a few days later in Denmark or Germany, which is inexplicable, but probably like an anomaly, whatever. We discussed this a lot. And I often think of myself that I'm sometimes overexcitable. Yeah, I'm definitely overexcitable. I lose track, I get overexcited, I get like manic and a little wild and feral. And 37 minutes, fuck, I'm not even halfway. I often mirrored myself, and Arjen said basically the same, and often he went a lot further. The system is captured, the system is captured by big money. So normal populations are losing democracy, we are losing prosperity, we are losing equality, we're losing human rights. It's slowly the eroding, and we might say it's engineered rollback. That's my statement here. And I say that a lot of people are in precarious, financial precarity, societal precarity, human rights precarity, safety precarity, welfare precarity, even healthcare precarity, mental healthcare precarity. And I think that a lot of people in the Netherlands, it's noticeable, but I go to Czech country and people are dying. Go to Romania, people are already like dying and already dead. Large segments of the population live in a squalor, which is not even, that's like beyond dystopian. Third world is crawling into Western Europe. The developing this, I clearly see that the rich are getting richer. There were conferences. There was a guy, and I think I can see if I can link it in the video. There was a guy who spoke at a conference, and they asked him if he wanted to tell something about technology and about climate change and about the end of the world or whatever. And the elites, the oligarchs, were only interested is like If we flee to New Zealand or some remote place and build an estate there, and we have security guys, how can we keep the security guys from serving us even after society has collapsed? So the world has collapsed, and we have a whole bunch of resources there, and guns, and money, and food, and we have an estate. How do we keep the security guys from taking over the bunker or the New Zealand, whatever, survival mansion? Which is saying that there is clear signs that a whole bunch of these elites have given up. They realize at their level that the world isn't managed. There is no conspiracies. There is no structure. There's only a system that trudges along like a blind elephant. It sort of function in a forward direction. It's sort of there is still some momentum in the system, but the system is already very close to a sort of systemic collapse. And they say, we can't do anything about it. We might as well give up. And we go to New Zealand, and basically we have a cellar full of porn, and we have considerable amount of cocaine and a bunch of hot chicks and porn and big screen TVs and a generator and solar photovoltaics and a bunch of guys with guns. And I'm yeah well if I can't enjoy my billions in Los Angeles or in Malibu or whatever, I have to settle for the next best thing in a survival bunker somewhere at the Canadian border. I was interacting with a billionaire, someone very rich, trans, Martin Roblath, and friends of mine, really good friends from Washington, D.C. They visited the estate. Martin Roblath has a survival bunker off the, literally, like on a unapproachable mountain, which you have to meander through all these little roads in the forest with a snowcat. There's no way to get there. You have to go there with a snowcat, and then you end up in an estate which is clearly built to survive some kind of catastrophe. So she spent probably, I don't know, 20 million, 30 million, 50 million on a for her family, for her grandkids and her kids, or families and friends, or the foundation she runs. She literally, I was described such a place, along like New Hampshire, I believe, and you can't get there. It's impossible to approach it because you don't know where it is, and you don't know how it works, and you can only go with like treads off a mountain. The normal car won't even go there. So this exists, and even the most liberal of billionaires are taking measures. So yeah, what do the elites then do? They want to stay rich. They don't think that anyone else but them deserves their billions, so they assume that it's a tax. There's a small taxation on their wealth in swaying politicians, buying, capturing the system, creating wedge issues like trans debate. Ah, trans! They're trying to rape our children. Sorry, I'm imitating Natalie here with her voices. And they don't want existential freedoms. They want people who work, who show up for work on 9 in the morning, don't have blue hair, wear a business suit, who speak proper English, don't have piercings. The elites want a servile, not too educated, slightly precarious, fairly precarious, terrified people who have a mortgage and who cannot afford to miss 1 month of payment of their mortgage or their medical insurance or whatever. This is engineered, I think. And yeah, call it a conspiracy theory. That I think that's the essence of the thunderstorm, the rain, the hail and the rain and sleet of memetics that is being vomited over Western society. Then we have a big problem here. You get Probably at the highest levels, like World Economic Forum, is definitely a billionaire lobby. And then there's other billionaire lobbies who are duking it out against one another over our heads. You have to bear that in mind. There's no single Illuminati. There's like a whole cluster of Illuminatis. And some you can do business with, like the World Economic Forum is not hostile towards trans issues, but if you go to there's definitely lobbies from the Vatican, right-wing elements in the Vatican who have a sh load of money, and they are definitely funneling money at wedge issues that are about rolling back several liberal, humanist, emancipatory processes. And the scary thing is, and that is what Natalie says, is that Rad Fems clearly are aligning themselves with Fox News and conservative groups, and they get money. They get money. They get money to do their thing for whatever strange, arcane, occult, mysterious, ephemeral reason. Now we end up with the last problem is like say I'm a transhumanist and people will not listen. They will hear transhumanist and they will see something with horns in their mind. Transhumanism is about progress, and look up the definition, do that yourself. I'm not gonna bother with it. If you don't know what transhumanism is, you don't want to know. I can't change your mind, but there is a lot of alarmism about transhumanism. Let's summarize transhumanism as a not being overly superstitious about the use of technology. So if I mention a whole bunch of technologies, for instance, if I mention, like, say, well, in 15 years it might be possible to have, and I make this point quite often, genetic selection. So you take a baby, like a zygote, like a freshly fertilized embryo, or even not even fertilized, like, say, you have an embryo and you somehow activated embryo as to create a child that sort of fits in societal, medical, scientific, and parental margins of preferability. So you don't have like a distorted spine, or you're not blind, or you don't have major congenital things like a Down syndrome or something like that. So the parent says, "I want my kids to not have asthma." Okay. At some point, the technology becomes easier and easier to access that, of course, for the rich, but whatever. At some point, it will become socialized if this permeates far enough in some countries. Then there will be countries that say, we can't afford a genetic selection gap. China is doing it, so we have to do it as well. And I think that will be accepted very quickly. And then you will have the first men that will have babies, and the first women that will have babies. Interesting fact, which is pure blasphemy if I say this for a lot of people. A cow with some medical interventions has the same length of pregnancy as a human. Apparently, some scientists claim that it might be conceivably possible to put human embryos under very careful laboratory conditions in a cow. I was actually shocked when I heard this. And then gestate them, take them out, put them in a synthetic embryonic device, sort of like a couveuse, how do you call it? For children born prematurely. And then you have healthy human beings. So you can assume that in the next 10, 15 years, there will be progress in this field. And I have casually offhand claimed that it might conceivably be possible to clone, genetically select, clone, optimum gestate, and then in state orphanages, sort of like a Chinese model for a mass production of idealized, docile citizens. That could happen. Yeah, it could happen. It will be too late for China. China is already going off a demographic cliff. China doesn't exist in the current form in a few decades. Like, it's catastrophic there. But it's going to happen in China. You literally see old people, geriatric demographics die of starvation there because they don't have any income and nobody gives a damn about them. And the state doesn't have the resources or doesn't want to liberate the resources because they're too busy yelling at the Taiwan. And it's going to be bad in China. And any measures that I just casually offhand suggested, which reek of Nazi eugenics, they cannot be implemented in time. It's too late. But I think that a lot of countries will try nonetheless, and a lot of rich people will definitely do this. They will go. They say, "No, I'm not, I don't know," and then they go to another country, like say Guatemala, and there's a clinic there, and they stay there for a couple of months. Oh, I'm so happy! My pregnancy was a success. Oh, I didn't mention it. No, I didn't mention it. I was pregnant, and here's my baby. Here's my baby. This is my baby. Look, just the genetics. It's my baby. Yes. And a very healthy baby, and it might have been gestated by a rent-a-mom, so like a commercially rented mom, or it might be otherwise, etc. As a transhumanist, I make suggestions, and I'm not superstitious about these suggestions. Let's say climate change, sort of reflective material above the atmosphere in an Earth orbit. If I say this, I know that millions freak out when they hear this. If they would hear this, a lot of people would freak out. Taking care of old people with robots. Again, a whole bunch of boomers like start spit-faced, fall off their chair, start screaming, waving their canes around, and they says, "I don't want any robots." And a whole bunch of things of transhumanism are culturally ingrained right now because of historical reasons in the last century to be very offensive to a whole bunch of people. The bad politician in my country, the evil mother, Thierry Baudet, has mentioned, a Dutch politician, I was nonplussed and surprised. He mentioned transhumanism as the threat. He was snarling with deep resentment in his voice about the books and the statements of Yuval Harari. I love the guy, Yuval Harari. I am like listening to his podcast and I'm snickering when I'm walking across the street. The guy's so good. He's so good. I wish I had his skills. Yuval Harari and transhumanism and World Economic Forum, that's all a sort of Bilderberger sort of cluster of mirages of fear. And why is that? Because if you were to implement a whole bunch of very likely to work transhumanist solutions to the world's problems, say basic income, often discussed in transhumanist circles, say climate change, say life extension, how many things would we solve with like having life extension in the next 5 years? Just life extension, and then maybe a few years later, age reversal. I think it's completely on the books to solve demographic problems in the Western world, at least in Western Europe and America. Demographic problems can be easily solved clearly by funneling an almost negligible amount of money, a few billions, into life extension research. If we make it have revenues of like fallout or benefits of just a little bit of treatments and a little bit of medical intervention, and we make people grow statistically healthy a few years older. So you're like you have the this is what you call the health span. This is this. And you're born, you're not healthy, and you're old, you're not healthy. And the in between is the health span. That is the span of your life when you're healthy and have a good chance of being relatively happy. Statistically, your chances of being happy are like or productive. Let's call it productive. Economically independent, whatever. And if we extend that health span a little towards the end, but like just a few years, this is already enough to be a threat to pension funds. Just a year. Pension funds will immediately freak out because they don't have the coverage for that. But you would deal with demographic problems. You would deal with productivity. You would deal with overexploitation of resources. People who grow older and have the prospect of living to, let's say 150, I don't know, 150, arbitrary number. If people that live 150, they would definitely be concerned. If, like, say Trump would now know that he lives to 150 instead of he's going to die in the next 10 or 15 years, he would be very concerned about the future, and his politics would dramatically change. I think a lot of the world's problems is because a whole bunch of very rich, very influential people at the top have only a few years left. And in those few years, they don't want taxes to go to climate change management or life extension or artificial intelligence or international treaties or distribution of wealth or a basic income or healthcare, socialized healthcare or development aid in countries or a rebuilding program in Ukraine or Russia. Or helping people start businesses in Africa so they don't immigrate to Europe, or vaccination programs for everyone, or cybernetics, or neural interfaces, or virtual reality research, or there is a whole bunch of things that can disrupt existing market models, disrupt revenue streams, increase taxes, change the way the world works. Oh, fuck, I have to get you learn a new keyboard. Oh, a whole bunch of really rich people are not happy about that. And that's the thing we have to contend with right now. I had a few other bullet points, but I have to cut it off at an hour. Look at the elites in Moscow. There is a bunch of people in Moscow that were freaking out by the idea that Ukraine might become democratic, EU less corrupt. Ukraine is very corrupt, but not as corrupt as Russia. Russia was this corrupt, and Ukraine was at some point this corrupt. And if it would be EU, it would be as corrupt as, say, Hungary, so this corrupt. Can you imagine what societal model we have in Moscow? That they would are willing to conduct genocides to make sure that Ukraine doesn't democratize and become part of EU and NATO. What are these people willing to do in Russia? I don't think there's much difference what those same equivalent people are willing to do in China or in America or in the Netherlands. Who was that comedian that said, if people understood just how insanely rich these people are absurdly, completely out of whack rich with yachts and mansions and blow and hookers and horses and trust funds and fixed wing TVs. I don't know. There would be a revolution tomorrow, and people just don't want to know. I think people at some point realize this, but. Okay, I know this now. What I'm gonna do? Okay, I'm gonna pretend that I don't know. Because if I actually internalize this, yeah, I would be having to join some sort of revolutionary movement. Oh God. Yeah. This is not gonna end well. Because there is a pervasive hostility of progress and improvement. And that is spurred on by very rich people who do not want the status quo disrupted or changed. And they are throwing a lot of their money at propaganda at making sure that that doesn't happen. Through media, through social media, through argent provocateurs, or through sabotage, through lying about anything, and including, like, I want to keep that. Stores open, I want to keep the restaurants open, and all these COVID measures are ruining my life. What do you do with this? How do you deal with these people? I don't know, but I hope this video makes a slight bit of difference. Wow, 59 minutes. I really like talking too much. This is not good.